This whole idea started because this guy, Marius, went to a 3-day hackathon and wanted to create a Google Analytics-style world map that adds location data to IP addresses. The true 10x engineer does live among us. The MVP that was built allowed users to write Python code called app or plugin that can connect to their data pipeline to directly access and modify event data. Their MVP worked, but they started to notice some challenges. Each Python app had their own requirements.txt file to manage their dependency. All the dependencies would be installed together, which would lead to unexpected conflicts or version mismatches when different plugins require different versions. After experimenting with different solutions, they decided to use Celery and Node.js for their app platform. Celery is an open source task queue system that allows for distributed task processing across multiple workers and brokers, enabling high availability and horizontal scaling. When events are sent to Capture API, it would parse the event and add the event to the task queue that a Node.js app would consume and process. The Node.js app would then run some user-defined JavaScript on that streams of events, like adding additional data. Then it sends the updated event back to the data pipeline through the same queue for actual ingestion. You might be thinking, Nani? Running user JavaScript code, are they crazy? Isn't that super dangerous? Yes, it is. Their solution involved leveraging virtual machines with Node 14's built-in VM module, which allows running JavaScript code in a separate context. But using VM is not a security mechanism, even explicitly mentioned in the Node.js docs. This is because it can potentially lead to privilege escalation and resource exhaustion attacks. When executed, this code will immediately terminate the entire Node process by exploiting prototype chain manipulation. Knowing how dangerous clients' code can be, they looked into two strategies. Isolated VM is a library which gives you access to V8's isolate that runs in a new thread. This offers them to be able to control CPU and memory limits. VM2 is a sandbox that can be used to run untrusted code securely, each in an isolated Node VM context in the same thread as the rest of the app, but VM2 has no CPU nor memory enforcement. At first, isolated VM sounds like the right choice, but due to the nature of its strict isolation, it doesn't include many standard JavaScript APIs that are typically available, such as Fetch. In order to get Fetch to work, they would have to build a system of proxies, which would be too much effort. Ultimately, they decided to go with VM2, since it already has its own system proxy that allows you to share code between the host and each context. To balance security and functionality, PostHog implemented this model. All apps must undergo a vetting process before being made to general use. Users who choose to self-host can have the freedom to write and use any arbitrary apps as they see fit. Before we continue, I just want to take a moment to thank PostHog for sponsoring this video. PostHog is a single platform that offers a suite of powerful tools including product analytics, session recordings, feature flags, and more. It's open source and built for developers who want full control over their data. They also offer very generous free tier that doesn't need a credit card to sign up. Even if you go over, you only pay for what you use, which is great for starting out a new project. If you're keen on building a better product, check out PostHog. More details in the description below. Now back to the issue at hand. Once they saw how much value their MVP provided, they were ready to invest in it. The latest structure of the app consists of two key files, index.ts, which contains the main application logic such as modifying events, connect to external services, and interact with PostHog. The process event runs during ingestion and performs actions on incoming data. Run every minute, run every hour, run every day are schedule functions for periodic tasks, and the export functions and on events run after processing is completed, which is useful for exporting data to external services like BigQuery or Snowflake. Then there is the plugin.json, which contains configuration data for the app itself. When a user uploads an app to PostHog, they would import the required functions from the user and run them through custom Babel transform for extra security measures and execute it in VMs as part of PostHog's ingestion pipeline. Structuring their app this way allows users to add their own customization. Their original pipeline was written in Python, but the plugin server, as mentioned, was written in TypeScript. Once the app plugin finishes processing data, it would have to send it back to Python code for saving the data to places like Postgres. They decided to rewrite their entire pipeline process to TypeScript so that they can avoid the need to pass data from TypeScript to Python. The plugin server is now responsible for processing all events, update related models, and run all plugins. They use Kafka to help batch, split, and manage parallel work for their apps. Kafka is a distributed event streaming platform. At a high level, it works by using publish-subscribe model, where producers write data to topics. Topics are logical containers for data that can be partitioned across multiple brokers in a cluster. The broker sends the data to consumers who are listening to the topic. PostHog also use Redis to cache reusable data for apps, significantly reducing compute needs when processing billions of events, like figuring out which organization the data belongs to. The plugin server had evolved to manage all plugins and handles event processing. To maintain this scale, they had to use Fasina to create pools of Node.js workers. In each worker thread, it most likely still uses VM2 to run users' code. The workers' thread are responsible for executing the actual tasks assigned by the main thread. Each worker thread operates within its own VM, which contains the necessary logic for ingestion and connections to require extensions and libraries. To manage workload efficiently, a single worker thread can handle up to 10 tasks concurrently. Once a worker completes a task, it's ready to take on new assignments from the main thread. To further protect themselves against user-created apps, they also implemented a few safeguards. They restricted the available libraries to a curated set, preventing the use of potentially harmful packages. To avoid infinite loops, they employed a Babel plugin that injects code to terminate loops running longer than 30 seconds. For data integrity, they implemented a retry logic for event processing, utilizing Kafka's batching and dead letter queue feature. And as a final measure, all apps must undergo a review process before being made available. PostHog's app platform had evolved the company into a comprehensive product development ecosystem, featuring over 50 community-built in-house apps for various data operations. This evolution aligns with their mission to empower developers to build better products through improved data utilization. Once again, thank you PostHog for sponsoring this video. I hope that you were able to learn something new today, and as always, thank you so much for watching, and see you in the next one.